Good evening, and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. I am Chisa Kores, the chair of the Club's Science and Technology Member-Led Forum, and your chair for today, co-chair for today. We also welcome our listening and viewing audience, and we invite everyone to visit us online at www.commonwealthclub.org. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speakers, Drs. Anurag Mairal and Rajiv Doshi. Dr. Anurag Mairal is the director, Global Exchange Programs, Stanford University. He also has senior leadership roles with India and Singapore biodesign programs. In these roles, he is responsible for developing an extensive network of partners from the industry, academia, regulatory bodies, and investors in Asia and the US to foster these Asia-focused programs. Further, he directs the NIH-funded Global Exchange Program that offers students, faculty, and fellows at Stanford the opportunity to work on global needs. Dr. Mairal is also actively involved in the industry. He is a co-founder and executive vice president of Obis Medical, a consulting firm serving medical device industry in the US, Europe, and Asia. He serves on the boards of several for-profit and non-profit organizations and is a charter member at EPPIC. Previously, Dr. Mairal was a product director at Cordis and a development director, business development at National Devices and Components, both Johnson & Johnson companies. Dr. Mairal received a Bachelor of Engineering from NIT RIPER, a Master of Technology, IIT Bombay, and a PhD from the University of Colorado at Boulder. Dr. Mairal was also a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Twente, Netherlands, and at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. Dr. Mairal has an MBA from the Haskell of Business at the University of California, Berkeley. He is also a co-founder of South Asia MBA Association, a global network of MBAs with interest in South Asia. Dr. Mairal has over 22 publications and 7 issued patents. Dr. Rajiv Doshi, MD, is a consulting assistant professor at the Stanford University School of Medicine. Dr. Doshi serves as the executive director, United States, of the Stanford India Biodesign Program. This program, founded in 2007, is a Government of India-supported program to promote medical technology industry growth in India. In this role, Dr. Doshi works closely with All India Institute of Medical Sciences and the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi. Dr. Doshi previously taught medical device design courses at Stanford since 2000 in the departments of mechanical engineering and bioengineering. In addition to his academic role, Dr. Doshi is the founder and chief scientific officer of Ventus Medical, a venture capital-backed medical device company in Belmont, California, that markets products for obstructive sleep apnea. Dr. Doshi is the inventor of the core technology at Ventus. Prior to founding Ventus Medical, Dr. Doshi was a principal at De Novo Venture. Dr. Doshi earned BS in chemical engineering and MSc in biomedical engineering from Stanford University. He also earned his MD from Stanford University, where he was a Soros Fellow. Dr. Doshi has over 30 US patents issued or pending. Please join me in welcoming Drs. Anurag Mairal and Rajiv Doshi.
Before I get started with my presentation, I just wanted to say three things. One, as you heard in the introduction, we are academics, so you'll see lots of slides. But since we are from the industry as well, you'll see a lot of pictures on the slides. So that's going to make it easier. Second is that what you're going to see from these slides are a lot of questions that are going to come out of it. Hopefully, we'll generate a lot more discussion, a lot more questions, then we'll provide answers. That's part of the reason we are here, to actually engage the larger community and get your inputs and work with you to make something like this successful. And the last thing is, what we found is that whatever we are doing in India has a significance to what we are doing here in the U.S. Gone are the days when you could just have this firewall between what we did here and what happened elsewhere in the rest of the world. So in many ways, the rationale for doing Stanford India by Design is not so much doing good for India, that's part of it, but it's much more about doing good for the society at large. So a number of things that we will be doing there, hopefully will actually make their way back to the U.S. and everybody would benefit from what we do. So with that, let me just get started. This is a picture taken in 2011. This is Mumbai. And quick question, what do you see in that picture? Can somebody just raise your hands and tell me what you see in these pictures? What do you see? You see slums, right. What else do you, and you see skyscrapers as well, right? Well, you'll also see, if you really look closely, housing in between the slums and those sky rises, and that is the emerging middle class in India. So you see this India, which used to be very affluent, very, very small percentage of the population, and really poor people living in slums, but there's increasingly a growing population of middle class, by some estimates, 200-plus million middle-class Indians, that are demanding a particular kind of healthcare that actually meets their needs, they're willing to pay for it, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later on. But before we talk about that, let's talk about medical technology innovation in India. It's not that India has not had medical technology before. They've used medical technology for a long time in different ways than the way we have used it here. But here are two salient examples of medical technology innovation that took place almost two decades back. First one of these is what you see, Jaipur Foot. How many of you are familiar with Jaipur Foot? Quite a few of you. Jaipur Foot was an innovation that took place in Jaipur, which is a city in Rajasthan. And the gentleman who actually came up with this innovation said, there are a lot of these poor people who lose their limbs and their livelihoods depend on these limbs. Specifically, you know, walking and working in the fields and things of that sort. And he wanted to do something for them. He basically came up with Jaipur Foot that used local materials, locally sourced materials to replace their lost limbs so that these people could actually go on with their regular lives. It was a very successful innovation and has helped millions of Indians over the last two decades. And the picture that you see on the left there, that little child, it's a picture taken by one of the Stanford Biodesign fellows in Chhattisgarh, one of the rural states in India, very recently, about a month back. It's amazing to see what can be done with simple innovations like that. The second innovation that I just want to point out to is something called Arvind Eye Care System. This again is something that started almost two decades back, 15, 20 years back. Somebody who had a vision to bring about process innovation and technology innovation all together to come up with really cost-effective intraocular lenses for people who lost their eyesight, to bring eyesight to them. But it was done in a very efficient manner in camps that normally you wouldn't think you could do eye surgery in. So there was a process innovation involved, and to the extent that millions of Indians actually go through these operations now for little or no cost to them. But the point that I want to make here is that even though these were amazing innovations, they have helped millions of Indians, they are a little dated. In the sense, not a whole lot of has happened since then. There's been some incremental innovation since then. But there are a number of factors that are taking place that are affecting the way Indian healthcare system is moving, and in certain direction it's moving. And as I said, the middle class that I talked about in that picture, the first picture, is the primary driving force for that. So what is the future for medtech innovation in India? This is a quick overview of the country. You know, it looks like a pan with a handle. You see the six cities that are the metros in India, Delhi in north. You see Kolkata in the east, Mumbai in the west, and three cities in south, Chennai, Bangalore, and Hyderabad. If you notice these metros, which where healthcare is really top-notch, you see a lot of tertiary care hospitals there and lots of doctors in located in these major cities. What comes to your mind right away? I mean, you see there's a high concentration of healthcare services in South India, right? So there's an asymmetry in terms of the healthcare access to healthcare in India. And that asymmetry gets worse when you consider metros and the rural areas that may be just 100 kilometers away from these metros. So another quick thing I want to point out, even though it's 1.1 billion population, half of India is below 25. So demographically, it's a dramatically different country today than it was two decades back. Half of the Indians are considered to be in middle class, but 40% are below poverty line. Very striking numbers. There are three, you could basically distribute the country in three different tiers of healthcare access: tier one, which is the metros, tier two, which are these mid-sized cities, and tier three, which are much smaller cities and rural areas. Another quick slide that talks about where India is going, where it comes from. As you can see from that slide on the left, the graph on the left, the economy has been growing very rapidly in India. It's one of the fastest growing economies in the world. As a result, the country has a lot more money to pay for its healthcare. Traditionally, India has spent 2%, 2 to 3% of its GDP on healthcare, which is inching towards 4% now, but it's still substantially below what is considered to be optimal, which is 10%, and much below what we spend here, which is 17-18%. That's kind of excessive, we believe, but I think healthcare spend in India is way below what it should. And actually, you can see that on the right side graph. What you see in the blue there is the optimal spend based on the 10% expenditure, GDP expenditure on healthcare, if you really want to keep your population healthy and optimally healthy. But actual spend has, even though it's grown only linearly. It has not really kept pace. As the lifestyle diseases dominate the healthcare system, as India moves from the infectious diseases spectrum to more lifestyle diseases, this sort of spend is probably suboptimal. And that actually tells a lot about which way the Indian healthcare system should be going. About half of, more than half of India's world's cardiac patients are in India. They will be 60% by 2015. It's already diabetes capital of the world. Really sobering numbers. Infectious diseases continue to stay prevalent. So you see these two Indias suffering from different kinds of conditions. Quickly, about healthcare system in India, 80% of it is private. Even the government is supposed to have extensive healthcare facilities all across India, because of the lack of investment and lack of availability of physicians and nurses, most of the healthcare centers aren't really staffed very well, which means a majority of healthcare is provided for by the private sector. And that ranges from really top-notch corporate hospitals all the way to little clinics by quasi-educated physicians. There are 160,000 primary healthcare centers that really provide, they're the primary source of healthcare. These numbers are growing very rapidly, but they are small right now for the country as large as India. I mentioned there are a lot of physicians and nurses, but it only is half the number that India needs. And the sector, medtech sector, which is the focus of today's discussion, is $3.5 billion, but most of it is in syringes and gauzes and things like that. So real medical technology that actually can cure people of serious diseases like heart disease are still not a major part of this investment. So let's talk about the medtech industry itself. India has traditionally relied on pharmaceuticals and traditional Indian medicine for the longest time, and for a good reason. They work, and they're easy to use. They are easy to distribute. They are easy to deploy. You just take a pill or you take a powder in Ayurveda, and it gets you better. But there are things that you cannot do with these therapies. There are things that where you need medical technology. And our belief is that as India grows further economically and in terms of its lifestyle and access to a range of career options, it will require a substantial investment in medical technology, because after a certain point, medical technology is probably the last recourse. A case in point is heart disease, where you could potentially do pills to a certain extent to maintain your blood pressure and even to address your heart disease, coronary artery disease. But beyond a certain point, when the plaque has really gone up to 80, 90% of your artery and you're about to get a heart attack, a preemptive implantation of stent is probably the best way to save lives. So medical technology does become an important participant in healthcare, which is the case in the rest of the developed world. So, but there are challenges that face in Indian medtech industry. First of all, the medical technology that exists in India is not tremendously innovative, and the part of the reason is that it hasn't needed innovation so far. Two-thirds of manufacturers focus on things like syringes. Very little is invested in R&D, and that's true not just medical technology, but also in pharmaceutical industry, by the way. Very little talent exists. There are a lot of really smart people in India, engineers, doctors, who are needed for medical technology innovation, but very few of them are trained in medical technology innovation, which is where Stanford India Biodesign comes in, which Dr. Doshi is going to talk about later. There's very little capital for risky ideas. Part of the reason US actually did so well with medical technology was because of the risks that investors took early on. The government took risks, the venture capitalists took risks, and there was a financial support for many of these innovators. We believe things are changing in the US, they're getting worse, but we think things need to get better in India to promote medical technology innovation. There's very little communication that happens between physicians and industry. In fact, physicians think of industry as evil. They try to stay away from the industry as much as possible. That sort of distrust has to go away because the objectives of the physicians and the industry are the same. They all want to treat human conditions. So there has to be dialogue, there has to be collaboration. Most of the healthcare innovation that has taken place in the US has a large amount of that innovation has been driven by physicians. There's very limited infrastructure for the entire process of medtech development. It involves testing facilities and prototyping facilities and things of that sort. Very few people who have really done this exist in India. A lot of them are here, and those who do exist in India are few and far between. And last, but not the least, is those of you who are following politics in India, you must have seen a lot of news about corruption, anti-corruption stir in India. That's a major constraint for any sort of innovation to take place in the country. But there's reason for optimism. That's why we're here. That's why we've been doing this for the last 4 years. We see that disease pattern is shifting, which means people are going to be a lot more open to medical technology innovation. They're going to ask for it. They're going to demand it. The stent market in India is already $150 million. That's considering how lower cost stents have become very prevalent in India, but people are demanding it, people are asking for it. People are saying, I have heart disease, I have 80% blockage, I need that stent, where is it? And they're actually increasingly tier two, tier three markets are getting these devices. There's an emerging middle class, which means there's money. People are willing to spend for their health. As soon as a patient is diagnosed with a life-threatening illness, there is a pressure by the family to actually get it addressed, and medical technology often becomes a solution. There is a tremendous improvement in healthcare infrastructure. There are a number of these really leading hospitals that have set up shop, not just in Delhi's and Mumbai's of India, but also in smaller cities and towns. And in the same hospital, the same really fancy hospital, you will have the top floor treating ministers and leading industrialists, and the third floor treating really poor people who are being paid for by the state government. So you have this access to healthcare that spans the cross-section of the society. There is an increasing health insurance coverage. Most of the, about 20% of the population is covered in some capacity. The number is stated to go up to 60%. A large number of these people will be covered by the rural healthcare scheme that India is proposing. Very expensive, but India seems to be committed to doing that. I've seen things moving in that direction in my trips to India. There's a certain respect for intellectual property and the regulations that you're starting to see. Policymakers are becoming very sensitive to it, and so are the professionals who are involved in it. This actually speaks to the first point about the growth of chronic conditions in India. It's not necessarily a good thing, but it is a changing scenario. As people are doing more and more sedentary jobs in information technology or financial industry or things of that sort, a lot more knowledge-intensive jobs, there's less physical activity and the lifestyle changes in terms of the food habits and so on, and that has led to these conditions actually growing very rapidly, coronary artery disease, diabetes, and so on. Part of the reason is change in the diet, as you can see. This is really tongue-in-cheek, but what it says is that the food habits have changed dramatically in India, and that contributes to some of these diseases. There's also this rise of middle class that I spoke about. This is a slide that was put together by McKinsey, and what it really shows is this upward mobility within India of various segments of the population, and the terms used here really represents from top to bottom, really affluent to really poor. As you can see, by 2025, a large number of these people will move from below the poverty line into middle class, and that will change the nature of healthcare that you're going to have available in India and the demand that is going to be placed on the healthcare system. They'll also have a different set of needs, as I pointed out. On the picture on the right, upper right corner, is a family of six. This was, for the longest time, this was the only means of transportation. This is somebody from probably a lower middle class family can afford a motorcycle, and six people could comfortably sit on this motorcycle. Well, so but their aspirations have changed. They can now afford a four-wheeled vehicle, but they don't want fancy vehicles. They don't want a Mercedes. They just want a vehicle that has four doors, or maybe two doors even, that people can sit inside and comfortably, and it's a car. It's a car that actually takes them from point A to point B. Tata's Nano was designed with precisely these people in mind. So the change is not in the objective. The change is in the way that objective is met. So that's kind of, it's really synonymous with what's happening on the healthcare, on the medical technology side as well. People are demanding therapies that, for example, stents. A lot of stents that are used in India today, about 5 years back when I went to interventional cardiology labs in India, 70% of the stents were American-made, and 30% were Indian stents, which are much cheaper, about half the price. Well, over the last 5 years, the number has shifted in favor of Indian manufacturers, where the costs are a factor of two lower than the cost here. So you can see that people are willing to adopt new technology as long as it meets their needs, doesn't have extra belts and whistles. And I think right there is a very important lesson for us. Some of the innovation that is taking place in these countries in terms of cost, in terms of the way these technologies are implemented, could potentially have an influence on how we spend our dollars on our healthcare. One side note I do want to point out, you see those two cars on the right side, the Land Rovers and the Jaguars? Well, there are people in India who want those too. So even though medical technology for the masses is going to be lower cost and it's going to require a different kind of innovation, there'll still be a market for these top of the line medical technology. So you will see medical technology innovation happening in both arenas within India. By the way, both the Tata, the Nano and the Land Rover Jaguar are owned by the same car company, Tata. And as I pointed out earlier, that the lifestyle has changed, but the tastes are very uniquely Indian. So you see chicken Maharaja and Mac Veggie and Mac Alu Tikki, and this speaks to how India actually takes an outside concept and incorporates it in a very Indian way. So, It's a lesson for us. We have learned this over the last 4 or 5 years as we have done Stanford-India Biodesign. We have learned to make what we do suitable for the country. We have incorporated a lot of things that are very country-specific, and Dr. Doshi will talk a little bit about that. I spoke about the middle-class aspirations and how they are demanding better and better technology. The pictures that you see here, if I took these names off of it, the names of the companies and the products, you will think that these are products being sold in the U.S. Well, they are sold in India. They are cheaper than the products here. They're being made by an Indian manufacturer called Sushrut. Their manufacturing capability, their products are top-notch. They are at par with, in terms of quality, of the products here. Here's another one. It's called Medivet, this company. They're making cardiac rhythm management devices, pacemakers and the like. And if you compare, there's somebody from Medtronic in the audience, so you'll see the price comparison here, substantially cheaper devices. The Medivet device is not as fancy. It doesn't have a lot of things that, it may not be dual chamber, it may be single chamber, and so on. It may have a not as long a battery life, but it works. It's for, there's a certain segment of the population in the country that could benefit from it and does benefit from it. So the middle class is demanding a better and better access to these technologies, but at the price points that they're comfortable with and delivered in a way that they can access. And this actually slide talks about that access. I spoke to you about corporate hospitals. Well, Apollo is the leading corporate hospital. It's got 40 hospitals across the country. And they started with big cities. And it was considered to be this fancy five-star hospital. Indeed, when you walk into it, you think like you're in a five-star hotel. It doesn't seem like a hospital. It doesn't seem like a traditional, you go to all the Institute of Medical Sciences, it'll look really run down. Even though the healthcare is pretty good there, the look and feel isn't that of a five-star hotel. But these hospitals look like five-star hotels. Interesting thing is, Apollo has expanded very rapidly into tier two and tier three cities. You can't read the names of the cities. I will read them out to you. Ahmedabad, Bangalore, and the last two cities at the bottom, Chennai and Delhi, are all tier one or almost tier one cities. But the cities in the middle row, Bhubaneswar and Bilaspur, are tier two or even case tier three cities. You would not expect somebody with profit motivation to go set up a hospital in a tier three city thinking that there's not as much money. Well, there is money. People are willing to pay for it because they want good quality healthcare. And that is a very important lesson that Indian healthcare system has learned over the last 5 years or so. Taking cues from the private sector, the government is actually improving infrastructure. They're certainly waking up. There's this performance focus that Indians have certainly gained, and primarily driven by the youth who basically say, why can't we have the same thing in our city? Government is starting to improve infrastructure. A lot of that is happening in partnership with civil-minded society groups, as well as nonprofit groups and corporations as well. So first two names, EMRI and HMRI, are basically Emergency Medicine Research Institute and Health Management Research Institute. They really focus on providing services, emergency services, as well as preemptive services to prevent diseases across South India. And now they're expanding across the country. And state governments are actually partnering with them. Certainly they're seeing the ambulance you see at the bottom, 104, is HMRI ambulance. And ambulance you see on the right side is 108, which is an emergency ambulance. People, when they see these ambulances, they actually prostrate in front of them. They literally, I'm not kidding, I've seen this happen in Chhattisgarh, which is a rural area. They recently introduced there. People actually are so enamored by these life-saving vehicles that politicians had no choice but to endorse it and actually take it over. So what they have done is they pay for 90% of the cost. Management stays with the private sector. There's a management fee, but it's run efficiently and really smoothly, and it's saving lives. There are other partnerships for paying for healthcare. So for example, this was a new experiment about 4 years back in South India, in Hyderabad, Andhra Pradesh, called, I'm trying to recall the name of this healthcare scheme. But basically, what it was they were gonna pay for all the essential procedures, stenting operations and heart bypass and so on. But they're gonna let the patients choose, and these patients were all below poverty line patients. They're gonna let them choose which hospitals they went to. They had the option of going to the private hospital. They had the option of going to the government hospitals. Can you take a guess where they went? The prices that the government was willing to reimburse for were equivalent to what private hospitals were charging. So clearly, everybody went to the private hospitals. Apollo now has an entire floor dedicated to these patients. So what has happened is this sort of partnership between private sector and the government has actually made healthcare accessible to a lot of people, and a lot of governments come to power because of that. This I really want to show you. This is the leading edge of rural healthcare. If you go to really rural areas in India, there's nothing. I mean, they might have a little shack that serves as a healthcare center. And what used to happen was, for the longest time, you couldn't send a doctor there. A doctor would not go. A doctor would go and say, I'm leaving, or would pretend that he's there, but he's not really there. Well, the government figured out, well, they don't want to go there because there are no schools, there are no good grocery stores. I mean, the lifestyle it really sucks from a doctor's point of view. A doctor who spent millions of rupees in getting educated doesn't really want to go to these areas, even if he comes from there. That's why he studied. He wants to get out of there. Well, the government said, we got to do something about it. So they were very smart. They came up with this really unique program where they train nurse-like professionals, auxiliary nurse midwives. They, instead of a four-year program for these nurses, they had a two-year program. You see that on the right? That's the first batch for this particular training institution. I visited them 2 months back. There are 40 women, girls actually, they're just barely high school graduates. But they could speak in English, they could actually learn what was being taught to them. They are really the part of the state machinery. They are the ones who are playing the role of a nurse and doctor in some cases. The assisting them are these women up on the right, on the left, on top. They're called ASHA workers. ASHA in Hindi means hope. It's actually an acronym, A-S-H-A. And I don't know what it stands for, but different states call it differently. In 2000, state of Chhattisgarh actually came up with this concept. What they did was they asked for volunteers. They said, we're not going to pay you. We're going to ask for volunteers from each of the villages of 200, 300 people. We need one volunteer who wants to work with these nurses, these auxiliary nurse midwives, who basically, your primary job is to take the patients, mothers and babies especially, because the mortality and morbidity is highest in that population. Encourage them to come to primary healthcare centers. Have them deliver their baby in the primary healthcare center. If the baby falls sick, bring them to these clinics. And that dramatically changed the way the healthcare is provided in these areas. The morbidity dropped, mortality dropped. And these women who are not getting paid got a lot of respect. They suddenly became the most popular people in the village. They started becoming elected, getting elected as the representatives in the villages. They have these village councils, and they would become the head of the village council suddenly, barely 18, 19 years old. So this has really changed the nature of healthcare in rural sector. And it's an experiment in progress, but based on what I've seen so far, I've spoken with these women, and I'm very impressed by their motivation and their strength. The group on the left actually asked me, what was I doing in the U.S.? They asked me, if I was an Indian and I went to the U.S. to get educated, why I'm not back in helping Indians? So they had that confidence. They had that awareness that things had to be done. And from their point of view, I was wasting my time here. I beg to differ, but I couldn't argue with them there. They were more in number. So let me talk about a few other, few remaining factors that are actually helping Indian healthcare system really take off. Reimbursement, and I'm not going to go through details. There are a lot of insurance companies in India that actually reimburse. The corporations actually pay for their healthcare coverage, good corporations. And then I spoke about RSBY, which is the Rural Healthcare Health Insurance Scheme, Rashtriya Seva something. It's a Hindi word, but it stands for Rural Healthcare Insurance Scheme. And there are a lot of state-based schemes as well that have been established. It remains to be seen how well they get implemented. There's a lot of transparency thanks to information technology in many of these states. And the belief is that the money will go where it needs to go, but it remains to be seen. The RSBY insurance is really an example of a public-private partnership. And I think what's going to happen here is that even the government is going to pay for it, the private sector will have the option of treating these patients. And as I said before, hospitals like Apollo and even smaller hospitals are starting to create wings or departments dealing with these patients, dealing with the policies of this particular program. Last two slides on the factors support helping medtech innovation in India. Intellectual property. India is a signatory to PCT, which is the primary governing mechanism for honoring intellectual property. The filing is in English. There's quite a bit of patent filing that is going on. People are starting to become quite aware of the power of patenting and protecting those patents. So when local innovators start to protect their intellectual property, they will also respect intellectual property that's coming from the states and other places. which is all a good sign. And finally, regulatory process is evolving. For the longest time, medical technology was governed by something called Drug Controller General of India. It was treated as a drug. Devices are not drugs. they take much less time to develop. They need to get into market much more quickly, not 12, 13 years. So there's a new medical device regulation that's being debated in the parliament, and it's expected to be implemented in the next 3 years. So that really kind of summarizes my overview of healthcare industry, healthcare sector in India, and role of medical technology in India, and the broad applicability of medical technology for all of India, inclusive solutions for Indians, whether you're rich, middle class, or below poverty line. So we believe the future is bright, and this was part of the motivation that we started Stanford India Biodesign Program. And I'll hand the floor to Dr. Doshi. He'll tell us about what we've been doing last 4 years there, last 5 years almost. Raj.
Thank you, Anurag, for this, I think, a terrific introduction into kind of the evolving world of Indian med tech. So I thought I'd share some, really, the story behind Stanford India Biodesign, why we were engaged to work with the government of India, and really how it's progressed. And I think there's a lot of lessons learned, which I'd like to share with you all. So the program Stanford India Biodesign is now in its fifth year. And it's a collaboration between Stanford University and the government of India. And more specifically, there's two institutions that Stanford works with. One is called the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, which is really one of the top medical institutions in India and Asia and probably the world. And there's another institution called the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, which is really one of the leading engineering institutions in India and Asia. So we're very fortunate to work with these two groups. Our interactions at a higher level are with the Department of Biotechnology in India, which had the foresight several years ago to really come to us and see how we might together map kind of a future for medical technology innovation in India. As Anurag shared with you, there's a real emerging need for new medical technologies that service the needs of all segments of the Indian population. But the reality is innovation really needs to be at the forefront to help create those products. And that's why we were really engaged, I guess I'd say. At the same time, in addition to working with the government, we're also working with several foundations and some corporate entities like Stryker Corporation, which is very much a for-profit corporation here in the U.S. and worldwide. Same thing with Johnson & Johnson. The term COSAT is actually one of their divisions. So they're keenly interested in the future of medical technology innovation in India. And so they've been a very active supporter as well. Okay, so the question that most of you should have is, what is biodesign? What is the Stanford biodesign process and how is it relevant for India? What it is it's really a means of assessing clinical needs or problems that physicians and other healthcare providers, as well as the patients, are having in a geography. So identifying those needs, and it turns out there's many hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different needs that could be solved by medical technology solutions. So it's really finding those needs by being immersed in the clinical setting itself, and really just bringing a notepad and taking down these very, very significant number of needs. Then it's screening those needs to determine which of these, let's say 500 or 600 needs that you've identified, is the most relevant that you want to solve. So going through a very rigorous methodology to assess which ones are the most relevant. Then once you find those needs, to create would be solutions, and then ultimately identifying which solution of these group of solutions that you may have created is most relevant for the need that you initially identified. So we'll talk about that momentarily. This is just the idea of biodesign graphically. So if I were to spend some time in the Indian setting, you know, watching surgeries or in the urgent care setting, in the emergency room, for example, I literally might come up with 500 needs in several weeks, right? And they could be process needs, they could be just different ways of, intervening or surgeries, for example. But the point is that there's so many needs that represent problems for the practitioner and for the patient. So you make a list of those needs, then you'll using a, as I mentioned, a pretty rigorous process, identify which are the top needs that you actually want to solve. Because you can't solve the 500 different needs. You want to focus really on one or two or three which are most impactful and ones that are most relevant, you're most able to solve. And with each of these needs, you'll create a whole series of concepts, okay? And the end of the day, you'll probably choose one need and one solution to really advance, right? That's really the process. And I'll tell you what the process is not. So it is not a technology looking for an application, right? Frequently we hear of, a brilliant inventor come up with a new technology, but then they had to find a need to solve. This is exactly what this process is not. We start with a need, and then we create a solution which is relevant for that need. Okay. So in a more detailed sense, and I'm not sure I can even read this, this just shares that it is a very significant process, and it focuses on things, things like intellectual property basics and regulatory and reimbursement basics and business models to help you even identify which need and then ultimately which solution to work on. But then even once you choose your need and then your solution, there's a whole series of activities that help you really implement that solution, whether it's really developing an intellectual property strategy to a reimbursement strategy, which is more relevant here in the US than it is in India, to R&D, so research and development, to clinical studies, to regulatory strategy as well, and doing this all in parallel at the same time to really help you identify before you start this, it's in many ways multi-year process. Have you chosen the right thing to work on, and will you be successful by identifying what those key building blocks are in the process? Okay. So this is actually a photograph from 2007, and this was when we were invited by the Indian government, by the Department of Biotechnology, to come present our vision for medical technology innovation for India. So again, this is in New Delhi. It was really a meeting with the top government officials who have interest in this in medical technology innovation, to the top folks from industry, to the top academic institutions in medicine and engineering as well. And we basically pitched our vision of a program called Stanford India Biodesign. Fortunately, we've been working with the government ever since. They've provided several million dollars, which are really focused more on the India side to grow the program. On the U.S. side, we really have to do our best to fundraise, because we're actually not funded by any entity. So we go raise money from foundations and corporations. But the government on the India side has been very, very helpful in supporting the program, both from a financial perspective, but also from personnel and just advice along the way. Okay, so at the time we decided that the first couple objectives really should be to develop leaders in medical technology innovation in India, and also to create new medical technologies for India. As we came back to the US and really refined the program, we realized that we have an opportunity to make a much broader scalable impact. The Stanford brand is quite well known and respected in Asia, and because we were viewed as a non-biased entity that was really doing this for the good of the people of India, really without any other biases really to mention, we were able to bring together a much bigger group from, again, beyond the government, beyond the regulators, but even going into the industry. And so the idea is that, can we actually bring together an industry? Can we help grow an industry using the Stanford brand and our collective experiences, which straddle academia and industry? Okay, so what we came up with was a series of offerings, which the most important one, the flagship offering, is something called the Stanford India Biodesign Fellowships. We'll talk about that briefly. There's also a series of internships which we run through India. The idea is that in time, we will be training our colleagues on the India side to replicate the program and then grow it really on the India side, really. So our involvement really is meant to be, five plus years to really grow that center and expertise, and then allow them to really grow it throughout different centers in India. Okay, so but in the internship is just the first offering, which the Indian side of the operation was really doing on its own. There's various faculty exchanges where we bring faculty members from India and train them in our methodologies here at Stanford. We run an annual medical technology summit, which is really the first of its kind to bring together the broader ecosystem in India in medical technology. We have a national SIB center, Stanford India Biodesign Center in India, which in some ways replicates what we've developed at Stanford. And we've also developed a networking community called indiabiodesign.org, which is, again, in enabling people who aren't part of our program but would like to be connected as a larger group. These are our fellows. Again, the fellowship is the most important thing that we do. We take 4 fellows per year. If you look very closely, you'll notice that they're all Indian, so it's really for Indian nationals. They come to Stanford from India, and they spend 6 months, and they learn our processes, and then they go back, and they go use these processes. But they do this, they do their needs finding, for example, in the Indian context. So they're not coming here and finding problems to solve here and then exporting it back to India. Rather, they're learning our processes, how we go about approaching problems and solving them, then going back and really starting the entire process on the India side. I've actually learned quite a bit from just interacting with this really young, dynamic group of innovators from India. We've learned a lot about developing medical technologies for India. So we've, you know, arguably been some of the biggest beneficiaries is learning from these folks. Okay, so a little bit about the process. So for the first 6 months, actually taking a step back, the fellows are basically found through a worldwide search, although it tends to be clustered mostly in India, where we really go try to find the top, you know, the top 4 innovators we can in medical technology innovation. They tend to have work experience. Several have been professors at some of the elite institutions in India. But we've been very successful in really bringing some of India's best and brightest to be part of the program. The benefit of bringing the professors is that when they go back to India, they go back to their institutions, they can set up their own programs, right? So it's meant to be a scalable program, and we're using education as a means to scale. Okay. So the first 6 months are spent at Stanford. Then they go back to India in the heart of the monsoon season and you know, redo their clinical immersion and really take their projects on from there. But they spend 6 months here at Stanford and then anywhere from 12 to 18 months in India before they launch their own projects. This is just a couple, you know, some photographs of the clinical immersion. In some ways, it looks very similar to what you might see here in the U.S. with some of the high-end equipment. This is, you know, the last couple of years, the focus has been on maternal and neonatal health. The idea is that those are two areas that are in some ways neglected by a lot of the companies and a lot of the people, unfortunately, in India. The pregnant women and young children don't always get the opportunities that they need, and certainly a lot of the healthcare that they need. This next slide actually shows some of the differences between just how healthcare is delivered in India. So I'll just focus on maybe the second one on the top. Yeah, that's the waiting room, for example. So a lot of these people come from 300, 400 miles away. They may be coming by train. And when they come, they typically bring the family, and they may not be one family member, maybe several members of the family, and they tend to camp out in the waiting room. So the waiting room is pretty chaotic, for example, for the doctor services, but they're very motivated to go 300-400 miles for definitive treatment that represents a certain level of desire. But you can just see it just looks a little bit different than we might be used to here. Once it gets to a stage where the fellows have identified various needs, they'll select one or two and they'll start their prototyping, for example. So prototyping is a, you know, ubiquitous art, but and that's something that we can all, you know, that could happen here at Stanford, it could happen in India. It tends to happen, it's very comforting for an engineer to start making things. Okay, so just a few more slides, and I'll share some examples of things that we've learned. So some lessons learned. I know there's some people in the audience who really aren't very involved with medical technology, but there's some that are. So some of this may be directly relevant for those of you already in the medical device arena. So as Anurag mentioned, talent with relevant expertise is generally lacking, right? And that's really the purpose of our program, is to help create that talent. Early venture capital is, again, not really present, so we need to really, as we're developing this program, we're hoping that the funding sources also come into the picture as well, because that's critical. The government's been quite good in providing early seed support. Some seed capital might be $100,000 or $200,000, but there tends to be a significant gap after that. Okay, manufacturing actually, at least in medical technology, needs to have a big upgrade. A lot of it has to do with the quality systems that are in place that are required for really good medical devices to be manufactured, but that takes some time to develop, and hopefully in the next 5 or 10 years that'll improve. R&D, or research and development, is challenging. There's a limited number of vendors, and even the quality of the products which might go into a bigger product, the parts may not be at the same quality, for example, that you might expect or require. As Anurag mentioned, the doctors and the industry typically don't talk. So if you think about the U.S. industry, a lot of the best inventions come from physicians who may have an engineering mindset, but the physician is the inventor. In India, that's quite taboo for the physician to invent something. And then to work with industry. So how do you deconstruct that barrier? Because the reality is the physicians are the ones who are most knowledgeable what the most important clinical needs are. So how do you create those links? And that's something that we're hopefully developing in our program. There's limited animal testing facilities when we talked about the limited precedents. Okay, so key design lessons. So you need to create something that's inexpensive, obviously. Okay, ideally locally manufactured, because that all speaks to what you can ultimately, what the ultimate cost of the product is. But you need simpler manufacturing methods which are available in those geographies in India. The materials which would go into this manufacturing process should be locally available, right? So there's no point designing a product where the key materials are coming from the U.S., for example. It just adds cost and time, and it may, in some ways, may represent bad design. You need to design products that are suited for a rough environment. So dust and humidity are just part of the daily life in India, and they can absolutely destroy consumer products and medical products, for example. So designing features which make products more robust for India. Irregular power supply. For those of you who have familiarity with sleep apnea, the gold standard therapy is something called CPAP, where you plug it into the wall. The problem is, if on a somewhat frequent basis your power is off in India, that's a bit of a problem, right? So that's one of the inherent challenges. And then poor maintenance as well. So you need to design for that. You want to require minimal training by the user. So the healthcare practitioners, whether it's a doctor or the nurse or the other healthcare extender, may not be as well trained as their counterpart here. So how do you create something which is easier to use and implement? Again, this just makes the design process a little more challenging. Low upfront costs. So if you don't have health insurance, you don't want to pay a lot of money, for example, you don't have that money, right? So upfront cost is critical, something that's easily repaired. And again, what Indians may want may be different from that in the West. So we had the McDonald's menu. That's certainly the case here. So I think what's going to happen is that collaborations between Indian and non-Indian entities will be absolutely essential. In fact, I think will become the norm to create products for India. Okay. This is just one example. This is a product that which was designed by for the first batch of fellows in Stanford India Biodesign. So this is really one being a collaboration between an industrial design firm in the U.S. called Lunar Design, and we've got some friends from Lunar here today, and our group on the India side. But there's a device called an intraosseous access device, which is think of it this way. After a trauma, for example, after a motor vehicle accident, a car accident or a motorcycle accident, which are very common, very, very, very common in India, it may take an hour or 2 or 3 hours to get from the site of the accident to the hospital, right? In the process, someone may be bleeding and they may be losing blood volume in the process. So in the U.S., we have less of this issue because you can typically get to the hospital quite quickly, right? Pretty much wherever you are. In India, it tends to take much longer. But the challenge is you want to provide intravenous fluids or IV fluids to these people as soon as possible to help them get to the definitive, basically get them to the hospital so they're still living, basically. So in the US, there's something called an intraosseous access device, which is actually a reusable device, which looks like more like a drill, and you have this little disposable portion that comes, that attaches to it. But it's cost prohibitive for India. So the idea was, can we create something which is a very low cost product, which is actually a hand drill? So you can actually just kind of push this into the bone. I should mention that intraosseous access basically means putting a needle directly into the bone, typically the shin bone. And that turns out is a very vascular space, so you can put fluids directly into the shin bone, and it gets rapidly into your vasculature, okay, into your arteries and veins. So Lunar basically designed this product, which is a very low cost little drill that's hand powered, very low part count, can be designed, can be manufactured locally in India, but with a very low cost of goods that was relevant for India. This caught the imagination of Fast Company magazine. So last month they had a very nice article about this cross-border collaboration between Lunar Design and basically the Indian Biodesign program in India. And it was really a beautiful thing involving lots of Skype and FedEx. Those were critical elements. But just one example. Another example is actually, again, with Stanford University and the Jaipur Foot organization. So Anurag talked about this very low-cost foot, which is for amputees. This organization in India came to Stanford and said, well, listen, we have a lot of people who have amputations above the knee. So not only do we need to provide them with a prosthetic foot, we need to provide them with a very low-cost prosthetic knee. Can you help us design that? So a group of undergraduates and I think one master's student developed this in one of their courses. It's called the Jaipur Knee, as you might imagine, and it was featured in Time Magazine's top inventions. I think this is probably back in 2009. But this knee has been fitted in at least 600 or 700 patients so far in India, and I think that's scaling. But the important thing is it's a very low-cost invention using locally available materials that can be manufactured locally at a very low price point, while offering very significant clinical benefits. So that's another great example. Another example with a group called DREV, or Design Revolution, which is a group based in Palo Alto, which basically developed a technology for neonatal jaundice. So very frequently after childbirth, the babies will become very jaundiced, so their bilirubin shoots up, and it's potentially life-threatening. But it's a very simple intervention, which is to shine a certain wavelength of light at these neonates, these young babies, and it's a definitive definitive treatment. The problem is these devices in India typically aren't that robust, and there's a need for a well-designed, low-cost device which would be broadly applicable. So the design was created in Palo Alto, but in close collaboration, based on an Indian need, which was well documented and developed. But then ultimately it led to a distribution agreement and manufacturing agreement with a group based in southern India. So we've got some friends from DREV here in the audience. And then finally, I think the path forward for a lot of the multinationals, and there's several folks from the multinational community here, and by that I mean groups like Johnson & Johnson, Medtronic, General Electric, groups that you would know. A lot of them now are developing in-country presence. So they're looking to create products specifically for the emerging markets, for India, for China, et cetera. But what they're finding is that they can leverage R&D or research and development efforts in the country to find the needs that are relevant for the population. But then when they hit a roadblock, they have various operating groups here in the US or in Singapore or Europe, for example, where they can leverage some of that expertise, whether it's manufacturing or other types of expertise that really helps ultimately create these products in India for India, but it's with some help. So I think that's really the pathway for the future. These international collaborations are going to be very, very common. And I think that's it. We've left a little bit of time for question and answer. So maybe I'll ask if any of you have questions, please go ahead.
Our thanks to Dr. Doshi and Mairal for their comments here today. We'd like to remind our listening and viewing audience that this is a program with the Commonwealth Club of California, Medical Technology Innovation for India, with Rajiv Doshi and Anurag Mairal. Now we open the floor to a Q&A. We have two standing microphones, one there and one here. If you have questions, please line up behind the microphones and speak into the microphone.
Hi. I would suggest that nutrition, sanitation, and inoculation have saved more lives than the medical establishment. What progress is being made in those areas?
So I can probably take that. But before I take your question, can I quickly introduce two key people that are part of our global biodesign program that are sitting in the audience? Christine Kurihara, who's a major force. Christine, do you want to just stand up and get yourself seen? And Justina, who works with Christine in our global program. Justina. Just wanted to recognize them because a lot of stuff we do requires a major team effort. Everything we do requires team effort, and we have a great team. In answer to your question, you're absolutely right answer. You do need to focus on those things before you get to medical technology and pharmaceuticals. One of the slides that I showed had these two groups of women, A&Ms and ASHA workers. They are not only focusing on healthcare, they're not only helping mothers and babies get to the clinic when they need to, they're also looking at hygiene and nutrition. In fact, there's below, if a child is below six, they go to this local, something called Anganwadi, which is like a play area where they are given these government-supplied food supplements. So they're there whole day and they are provided these foods, which are very nutritious. And I've seen these packs. They're pretty good, actually. They're a mix of a number of different grains. So things are happening. I think there's a lot more awareness of these issues. And we believe that you need to make an effort in all areas, not just nutrition and hygiene, but also in delivery of the right kind of pharmaceuticals, price controls on them, and then medical devices. Yeah.
Maybe this is a little controversial question. What is done regarding birth control in India?
I don't know very much, Rajiv, you want to take
it? I'm not sure I have an answer.
So since I don't work in that area, it's hard for me to answer. What I do know is that India actually promotes birth control quite a bit because it's population explosion is a major concern for India. From what I hear, it's well accepted by the society, both urban and rural society. Number of kids per family are going down quite a bit. That could be a problem for India in the long term because, the whole system of social support actually kind of starts to break down. So they'll have to figure that out, but yeah, that's all I can offer there.
I have a question. It's really interesting to see all those really inexpensive medical devices being developed. What is the regulatory system in terms of approving these locally developed and manufactured devices, and what kind of clinical evidence is required?
So you're the regulatory expert. I'll let you.
India, for the longest time, was the medical device approval took place through DCGI. And in fact, if you really dig deeper, until 6 years, 7 years back, there were no regulations for medical devices. As long as you went and registered the device, you're pretty much free to sell no matter what device it was. Something happened about 6-7 years back. A European company launched a drug-eluting stent in India, which actually led to major issues. I think there were some deaths as well. And suddenly the government woke up to the fact that there were no regulations. So they arbitrarily came up with 10 categories of devices that were regulated that had to go through the same process that drugs need to go through. But the government recognized after inputs from the industry that this was arbitrary and wasn't really helpful to the community, to the society. So this MDRA, Medical Device Regulatory Act, which is being debated in the parliament, is actually to address that. And it looks very much like a CE mark. But until that regulation actually gets approved, India allows companies to get a CE mark or an FDA approval and go to India and just do a simple registration. A lot of companies do that.
Yeah, I think you'll find also that the physicians and even the patients really value, maybe overvalue, an FDA clearance. Yeah. So even though it may be ultimately something approved in India, for example, the reality is it's got the FDA clearance and less so, I think, CE mark. it tends to, that brand really helps, I think, with believability that it's a good product.
Right, but how do you get the local products to the market, because you don't get a CE mark for those local products?
No, you can. You can. So a lot of stent companies, there are three stent companies in India, four now, that have all taken the same route. They have basically developed the devices in India, and then have gone to Europe and gotten CE mark, and then they have launched it in India.
Okay.
They don't need to do that. They didn't need to do that when they did it, but they did it because it got them, as Raj said, credibility. I think you also asked about clinical trials, right?
Yes.
Clinical trials are okay as long as you are an indigenous manufacturer. You could actually work with doctors locally with some basic paperwork. But if you are coming from outside, there's a major resistance to that. They don't want to be guinea pigs. So there's the perception that if a company is coming from outside. Mm-hmm. So that's another reason why major multinational corporations like J&J and Medtronic and all are starting to think about local development of devices, and then you go to the clinical trials locally, and it's much easier that way.
Okay, thank you.
So actually, I had a question very similar to the last one, but I actually have another question regarding specifically the biodesign program and the bone drill that you were discussing earlier. What sort of testing, animal testing and like feasibility or validation did you perform? And is something, the Stanford biodesign process, is that something that is looking at specifically like low tech, primarily mechanical technologies, or something like more sophisticated that requires a little bit more development?
Let me try to maybe address the second question first, which is what types of technologies are of most interest to Stanford Biodesign. The answer is it's really at the discretion of the fellows. So anything where it could be very high end with thousands of parts, or it could be five parts. It's really it can be just mechanical, it could be electromechanical. It's really up to the fellow to decide kind of what the need is and making sure that the solution is relevant for that. For that need. But with regard to the first question, the question was with regard to the little bone drill that I showed you a picture of, what type of testing did that go through? So I think it's important to point out that every product probably has a different pathway as far as preclinical testing. In this case, and given the nature of the product, because we weren't, it was similar in many ways to other products that have existed for many, many, many years, the path that we chose was we actually went to use the cadavers in India, basically through the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and did some of the testing in cadavers. So initially it was you create a product, you create a prototype, and you experiment on chicken bone that you might get from the local butcher, or I don't know if it was lamb or the meat of the day, I guess, but you can practice boring through a bone in that setting. Once you have success there, then the next logical step was either to do a live animal study, like a larger animal, but that's hard to do in India, and I think that would be of limited merit because it's a product that's very similar to prior products that are on the market. But in this case, we went to cadavers and just to make sure that the device could get through a bone quickly. Yeah.
I actually have an add-on question as well. So do you see, a question for both of you, but do you see technology coming out of India that kind of goes the other way, where the technology would benefit people here in the U.S. rather than the other way around?
Absolutely. Yes, yeah, so in some ways I think that's the future. The question is, can something created in India be more broadly relevant? And I actually think whether something designed here in India, designed in India and then exported here, or if something that's being designed here for the U.S. population, but also at the same time, it's relevant for the emerging markets. I see no reason why you cannot create products that are globally relevant. But it's really on a case-by-case basis. Some devices will be quite helpful. It could be just the segment that you're targeting may well be completely different. My personal experience is with a company that makes a device for sleep apnea. It's a disposable device which creates positive airway pressure, but it's a little pretty simple device. That you wear once and throw away. In the U.S., I think the focus is going to be mostly people who have given up on the gold standard called CPAP, which is a big ventilator, or for those who have more mild to moderate disease. And in India, I think this device is more broadly relevant for all segments because there's less a need for an upfront, big upfront payment, and then just issues with electricity kind of going on and off. So the point is, a product could be globally relevant, but for different reasons, in different geographies.
Great, but, thank you.
Okay. Actually, there's one example that I want to share with you about product coming from India, coming back here. One of the J&J companies, LifeScan, had a glucose meter, a number of glucose meters that were very fancy. But when they were trying to commercialize those devices in emerging markets, there was a resistance because of cost. So actually, J&J asked their India team to come up with a glucose meter that was cheap, robust, easy to use. They did, and it was, I think, factor of five cheaper, very successful in emerging markets. And a physician actually went to India and saw the device and said, well, we can use that in the US. He reached out to LifeScan leadership here, and next year they launched a new line of glucose meters. The only change that was that they made was instead of dull gray color device, they launched it in four colors. And it was three times more expensive compared to the Indian device. So there is value in reverse innovation, yeah.
Thank you.
In terms of healthcare delivery, to what extent is the Indian system still very much hospital focused, as you showed, or are kind of the evolution that's happened here, outpatient surgery and then procedures done in the physician office, is that happening? And then in the latter context, what are the opportunities for Indian physicians to be in, quote, private practice, running their own show and using devices and doing procedures, especially in the office?
Right.
Yeah. Oh, why don't you go ahead?
Okay. More familiar. So I think increasingly, just like everywhere else, outpatient procedures are preferred. Medicine is moving out of major hospitals into smaller clinics and from smaller clinics to outpatient offices, into the clinicians' offices. Also, there is this tradition of health camps in India, especially for the below the poverty line patient population. Arvind example that I provided, intraocular lens surgery, a lot of that happens in actually in large-scale camps that are not necessarily based out of hospitals. So I think there is a movement in that direction.